ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the first meeting of the municipal year for the Audit and Governance Committee for the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority. And before we start the meeting, there are a few housekeeping matters to just resolve with you, and then we can move on to the appointments of a chair. In terms of the housekeeping announcements, we ask all colleagues to turn their mobile phones to a list of silent microphones. We need to remind colleagues that presenters to use the microphones, so that it's a new system that's been installed and it's quite sensitive, and you don't need to move the microphones, it will pick your voice up. In terms of fire safety announcements, there is no fire alarm test today. If there is a fire, the fire alarm will sound. You'll need to leave the building immediately via the side exits and make your way out of the building as quickly as possible. The assembly point will be outside the Liverpool Museum on the concourse outside the Basco coffee shop. In terms of filming and photography, colleagues will be aware that we've installed a new system, which means we are broadcasting live on the Combined Authorities website, and the whole of the meeting will be filmed. The exception to that is when we're dealing with confidential items, but that doesn't apply today. If you make a representation to the meeting, you are deemed to have given consent to being filmed. And by entering the chamber, you are also consenting to being filmed and to the possible use of those images and sound recordings for webcasting and or training purposes. If you do not wish to have your image captured or you have any queries regarding the webcasting of the meeting, can you please let one of the colleagues of Democratic Services know? And you should be aware that the Combined Authorities Data Controller under the Data Protection Legislation and data collected during the webcast will be retained in accordance with the Combined Authorities published policy. Hopefully you're all glad that that's, those announcements are out of the way. So, without further ado, if I may move to agenda item one. May I have any nominations for the appointment of chair for the year 2019-20 for the Audit and Governance Committee?
I'd like to nominate Councillor Edna.
Is that seconded? Can that be seconded? Thank you, Councillor Pugh. Is that agreed? Lovely. Councillor Finneran, if you'd like to assume the chair, congratulations and thank you very much.
Are there any nominations for Vice Chair of the Audit and Governance Committee 2019-20? Can I nominate Paula Murphy? If that's acceptable. Is that agreed? Thank you. Apologies for absence. Are there any apologies for absence?
We've received apologies for absence from Councillor Haggart, Councillor Baines and Councillor Sarah Watson.
Thank you. Are there any other apologies? Have we any declarations of interest being received, or would members like to declare any interest on any item on the agenda, please?
We haven't received any declarations, Chair.
Thank you. The minutes of the previous meeting of the Audit Committee held on the 20th of March 2019 and included on page 1 to 6. Can I ask if these are agreed, please? Okay. purpose of this report is to provide the committee with the head of internal audit annual reports and the opinion in respect of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority for the financial year of 2018. Can I ask Laura Williams, head of the internal audit, to take us through the report, please? Thank you, Laura.
Notable to say from the start, and obviously the regular reports that are brought to this committee during the year will also bear this out, is that we have been very much involved in giving advice and support to systems within the Combined Authority as these have been developing during the last year, and that has taken more of our time than doing what you might call traditional audit work, which would normally generate a report and an opinion. And that is entirely appropriate for where the organisation has been over the last 12 months. That is reflected in the opinion, which you no doubt have the opportunity to read, and I'll explain in a little bit more detail in a moment, if I may, how that opinion has been reached. But in terms of summarising the work that we've completed during the year, as I say, it is a requirement of the Council Audit Regulations and also the Public Sector Internal Audit Standards I give such an opinion on an annual basis. Members will note from the report that some of the key areas that we've been involved in during the year have been giving advice and guidance, as I've said, on a number of key areas. So things like the adult education budget, housing first, and the apprentice travel scheme, for example. We've also done a lot of work, as members will note, on assurance of grants regime. So there are a number of grants, and these have grown quite considerably both in volume and value during the last year, which reflects the development of the CA during that time, and we've been heavily involved in undertaking the certification of those grants during the year. I've also outlined for you in the report some of the details arising from the annual governance statement, which is part of the accounts and comes up later in the agenda. And talks about some of the issues and areas that have been picked out as part of that document, which paints a picture about the governance of the organisation and where it has found itself over the last year, and some of the challenges that it's going to face going forward. I've also talked a little bit about risk management, and when you read the opinion in the report, you will note that the risk management element has been quite a key part of forming that conclusion and opinion. I have obviously kept the committee up to date during the year in terms of the progress that has been made in respect of corporate risk management, but members will note that it was late in the year when the corporate risk register was finalised, and so I brought that to you at the January meeting, and the arrangements around risk management have been very much developing during the year. So there is a theme here about arrangements developing, becoming embedded, and audit work really being aligned and commensurate with that. I've also talked a little bit about fraud and some of the general things that we've been involved in, and obviously there is one investigation in the Combined Authority that we have completed. It did run over into this financial year, and I've included a summary of the outcome of that in the report for your information. From the opinion, so that's sort of the main meat of the report, I'm giving an inadequate opinion, but with a capacity for improvement is good. The reason for that is, as I've stated, very much during the last year, as you would expect with an organisation that's been building up its activities and its scope and its remit, it's the arrangements, the systems and processes with which are really the foundation for CA's activities have been built up over that year. And so I can't be in a position where I say that everything is in place and everything is phase of real, what I would call delivery, those systems and processes are being built on, and I have seen evidence of that more recently, which would support that opinion. However, as I've said, a lack of embedded risk management arrangements during the year has also informed this opinion, and that is set against a backdrop of an opinion expressed by the external auditor this time last year around those opinions, so it is necessary to reflect that. But as I say, capacity for improvement, very good. I've seen more than green shoots in terms of developing this position going forward. So I can give you confidence and assurance that that is the case. I have also included, just for your information, in the opinion section, the opinion for Mercy Travel. And that's simply for transparency and for your information. I don't propose to go into it in any great depth today. But obviously, I have put before you, as the year went along, items of work regarding Mercy Travel that you would find interesting. So where Mercy Travel is providing systems, services, processes to the CA, it is clearly important that you are informed as to the quality of those services and internal control. So I have included that, and it is positive to say that that side of things is adequate. And so I think, as an organisation that has placed a great deal of reliance on Mercy Travel systems and processes and use those as the foundation for going forward, you can derive some comfort from that, but also the fact that the organisation now, the CA, has grown, and its scope and scale of its activities has outgrown what would have come out of or been applied for a Mercy Travel angle. Talked a little bit in the report about the effectiveness of internal audit. Again, a requirement of the exact internal audit standards that I talked to you about these matters. And I've included some narrative about the service and the developments that happened during the year, and looking ahead to what is our current year, 2020. Very happy to take any questions.
Do members have any comments?
Thank you, Chair. When I first looked at the report, I saw the word inadequate sort of left out on the page, and not kind of thinking what a new school report, and the explanation, I accept the explanation that it's a new organisation, private authority, and we put systems in place, and therefore you kind of have assurance on absolutely every point. But then it crossed my mind, as it probably crossed most members' minds, that actually part of the combined authorities, Mersey Travel, is a very long-standing organisation that must have some fairly robust systems in place, and I looked for your overall opinion on that, and it's not actually glowing, but it says adequate. Just probing a little bit further on that, the overall assessment of the combined authority was we needed to improve embedded risk management arrangements, and that systems and processes of many of the activities could be improved. Is it your view that this only applies to the elements of the combined authority outside Mersey Travel, or is it the case that in the process of the internal audit you were able to recommend to the Transport Authority, or what was the Transport Authority, improvements in their embedded risk management arrangements or in their systems and processes?
I think the first thing to say is that there is a adequacy is about as good as it gets in terms of these opinions, so it isn't glowing, but it never will be. I don't think it would ever be even more complimentary than that, simply because you can never know everything, you know, as head of internal audit, you can't audit every system, you can't see everything, you can only comment on the things that you have examined and the evidence that you've seen. So adequacy is really a way of me protecting myself from saying I cannot say absolutely categorically, never could, that everything is absolutely rosy in the garden. However, the point you make is a good one, that in terms of Mersey Travel, yes, there is an adequate system in place. It is very well embedded. It is more of a traditional organisation which has
Councillor Murphy.
Thanks, Chair. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to Laura and Phil and the rest of the team, because I think the work we've done over this last year has been outstanding and has really helped us as, on the committee as well, to understand the process, and so I appreciate that. I was going to raise the same issue Councillor Pugh's raised, but also I wanted to ask you about the 3.7 on the report, which is regarding the grant funding. Just if you could clarify, does every grant get checked through audit, or is it a sampling process? And also, you mentioned that you're not doing as much of the traditional audit work, and that you've done a lot of preparation with the adult education and housing fairs. Do you anticipate that being an element of the work moving forward, or would the plan still stay as it was from that we previously agreed?
We audit them basically on the basis of either materiality or what's required as per the grant conditions. So some of these grants actually have conditions attached to them that they need to sign from internal audit, or it will be that the sign-off has to come from John as the Director of Resources, but he would like us to have a more detailed look at it. So it varies from one to another. But what you have here is very much the most sort of significant ones that either say require it through the grant or more material grants that we would like to look at. But we are informed about all of the grants that are coming through, so we can take a view either on the basis of materiality or on the basis of what's in the grant conditions that we find. On the second point,
it's regarding offering support to new development of the authority.
Thank you, apologies. That was very bad. The audit plan that came to this committee back in March was a full audit plan with substantive audits of all of those areas. So it is our intention, and we've already begun this work, of actually looking more substantively at those audits and starting to issue traditional audit reports and opinions. So yes, this will be sort of much more normal audit plan, as it were. Last year was very much, and I think the year before I was here, very much exceptional years, really, where they think the development wouldn't have been appropriate for us to really think to audit. It was very much sort of looking at how things are being developed and whether those things were appropriate and giving that advice and guidance. However, you know, we are still in a position where those systems and processes are still continuing to be built up as the CA increases its activities, devolution increases, etc. So the advice and guidance role is one that I see as really crucial going forward. And it is important that we continue to be enmeshed in those developments so that as new things are coming on stream, we can be involved, we can give our views on and give advice. So it's very much an amalgamation of those two things. But as I say, this 1920 plan is much more a traditional audit plan of actually looking into those areas that are now in delivery.
Recommendations are set out on page 7 of the report, please. Thank you. Item 7. The purpose of the report is to provide the committee with an overview of the audit work completed in respect of the combined authority for the period since the last report, 28th February, June 30, 2019. Can I ask Laura Williams, please?
So this report, very much on the back of the one we've just considered, is about the work that we've undertaken in respect of the combined authority for ostensibly the first quarter of this year. There is a little bit of work that goes into 18-19 because of timings of committees. What I've tried to do here, and it's always rather a challenge, I think we've already started started to explore this issue, is to present to you and summary on section two will hopefully help in terms of this, is to present to you basically everything that we've done, but to identify for you which organisation each piece of work relates to give that clarity and transparency. So the point has already been made that obviously noisy travel, it is important that you are receiving assurance that the systems and processes that that organisation is providing to the CA are robust. You also obviously need to know about the specific combined authority systems, and you need to know that those are robust. And there are also a number of very specific systems that are within Mersey Travel which relate to transport, which I have included simply for your information. And those are items that relate to items such as rail, bus, etc., which are not directly within the line of sight of this committee. However, you may wish to be informed about those. So as I say, section two, there is a summary of what we have delivered in the period. It has been a busy period. There's been a lot of audit work completed, which you will appreciate there. The other thing that I've tried to do in section 2.2 is to give you a feel for where we are in terms of delivery. So I have listed the pieces of work that we haven't yet commenced, given a very brief commentary of words just to indicate where we are with those. And that is obviously based on the audit plan that was approved by this committee back in March. And then sections 3, 4 and 5 outline key findings from each of those different categories of audits, if you will. So the corporate systems, 20 of those audits completed in the period, relating to both organisations. So this is ostensibly systems provided by Mersey Travel to the CA. And section 4 goes on to talk about the CA specific systems. Now, as I think I've already mentioned, there isn't a great deal here in terms of specific audit work because that is to come in quarter two, but there is again some audit of brands there for your information. And then in section 5, some of those Mersey Travel specific systems, which as I say are really just there for your information and system transparency. Those are reported through Mersey Travel through the audit risk and governance board, so scrutiny of those also happens there. And section 6 talks about our quality assurance and improvement programme, which is very much about internal effectiveness, and gives some stats around how we're doing in terms of delivering the plan. We're a little bit down, as you will have noticed, section 1.3, table 8, in terms of our delivery of the plan for the year so far. But we have been very productive in the quarter, so it's not causing any concern. We have done high volume of work, as you'll see, 34 audits in the period is a lot. It's unfortunate that one or two take us a little bit longer than we might have hoped, but nonetheless, I am hopeful that we've got so much work in the pipeline that we'll be able to pull that back in quarter two. I've talked a little bit about fraud and corruption. We've done self-assessment, refreshed the self-assessment on managing the risk of fraud and corruption, and pleased to say that we out with a high level of compliance, but there are some actions there. I've also taken the opportunity to include at section 9 some details around a new document that CIPA has produced, which is around the statement on the role of the head of internal audit. And this is really a key document about not only what it is, what it means to be the head of internal audit, and how I should execute that role and how I should seek to be effective in that role, but also what are the resources, the support, the tools that are required from the organisation to enable me to be in that space. And so I think it is important for the transparency and the knowledge of this committee that you have sight of that and visibility of that. And one of the things, again, very much building on what we said already in terms of developing the systems and processes of the CA, is that it is important that the internal audit service continues to have and continues to build its profile, so that it is involved and knows about these developments as they happen. It's obviously a very fast-moving environment that we find ourselves in, and we want to be in a position where as an internal audit we have opportunities to contribute to the development of those systems
members have any questions? Does anyone have any more questions? Can we now agree the recommendations set out on page 33 of the report, please? Thank you. Item 8, the risk management update. The purpose of this report is to provide the committee with an update in respect of the system of corporate risk and management and the activity that will be undertaken in embedding the system during the first quarter of 2019-20. Can I ask Laura to please?
Have now begun a process process of fully refreshing those service risk registers, and that is quite an extensive exercise, as I'm sure you would appreciate, and I will obviously be reporting the results of that back to this committee for a very brief time. Section 5 of the report is very much about how we continue to embed effective risk management, and again this committee has had and continues to have a really crucial role in assisting the organisation doing that, and myself obviously in the internal audit we have a facilitating role in respect of that, but we do feel that the progress that's been made is positive. We just need to keep going with that. So very happy to take any questions on that report.
Thank you, Nora. Does anybody have any comments
Yes, thank you. I looked through the list of registrations, had a slight on familiarity for me because in my own authority where they obviously compile risk registers equally, it tends to be very much, as I think you used the expression, at the service level where particular designated projects are rated in terms of the risks pertaining to them or their non-achievement. And I looked through the first sort of items on the risk register that have been put down, corporate risk register on page 81, and they seem to cover pretty well every imaginable eventuality, really. You know, fail to get sustainable funding, fail to get cooperation, fail to get required outputs. I mean, you've covered every base there. I mean, there's nothing that you haven't said in terms of authorities or activities that isn't in some way a risk, and everything's more or less graded 5. And then over the page, there are two risks, which are kind of generic anywhere, risk of major incidents, risk of cyber attack, can happen to any organisation any time. And I suppose what I'm really looking for and what the members are interested in is the level of granularity that tells you for specific projects, say for example, the tidal scheme, you know, what the risks pertaining to that are. And I understand from your explanation that you're working on that, but you've got that as a service level risk rather than a corporate risk, and I just sort of query really how granular this risk register needs to be, because my observation is it's very generic, and covers everything. It's almost a catch-all. Really, what we are concerned about an authority is the specific risks that may pertain apropos specific projects which involve specific sums of public finance being spent.
What I would say is that corporate risk register, in my view, should be about the most significant risks that the organisation faces. And so what I would say is, if it isn't here, at the moment it is for one of two reasons. It's either because we haven't yet elucidated some of those risks, which is what's happening through that service planning risk management process, or, and you use the example of time, or I'm going to speak for that, that the risks involved in that are not yet at a level, or not at a level, they're not scoring highly enough to feature within this document. So there are a couple of things going on. One is that we do have a comprehensive project risk management function, which is largely facilitated by the programme management office, have some exciting visibility over it, and projects such as Tidal, Digital and others are managed in that way. So there is a developing risk register around Tidal, for example. We've been very heavily involved in discussions around that, but in terms of granularity, I think that what we have here are the things that are significant enough to cause us a major problem. There are other things that might cause a major problem which don't feature here, but that is because of the way that those risks are being assessed and identified at this point in time.
Just go quick on that, Mike. I can help you and sort of explain it about my. I do accept that in some cases it's impossible, because the schemes are not sufficiently evolved, to put adequate risk attributions upon them. But you could almost write this risk register. Use the same risk register year after year, pick your first 5 items, they'd be there every single time. Something very specific though, like say the purchase of new trains on the motor travel network, obviously, I mean, hopefully there's very little risk. risk involved in that, but if it goes wrong, it has a very, very substantial impact. It relates to a very big commitment of money. And I would kind of expect to see this here, that there.
Can I try and help with that? Under risk one, which is failure to deliver, there's a huge architecture of programme management information which covers all the projects and programmes that are involved in at any one point in time. They're given a rating of red, amber, green. There's an architecture based around a programme management unit that we've put quite a lot of resources into in the last couple of years. Their output feeds directly into the combined authority, and the combined authority receives quarterly information that comes from that programme management unit. This risk register, as Laura says, isn't primarily where we deal with project by project risks, unless those project by project risks could jeopardise the existence of the combined authority. So there is exactly that level of granularity that you're talking about. It's related to this document, but it's not part of what this document is. But it's entirely within the gift and the terms of reference of this committee. If you want to see a particular project or program like Tidal or Digital, or the output of the program management unit, where you will see all our SIF projects, all our LGF projects, all the major Mersey travel projects, including rolling stock, housing first, households into work. Those are all categorised as individual pieces of work and projects, and given a status rating and a risk rating. If you want to see that, then I think that would be, if you feel that's useful, we'd be happy to provide you with that.
Coming back to that, I think that would be helpful, because then we could perform a useful function. And certainly, if you take almost like the first section where failure to effectively identify and address the impact of political and social and economic certainties, failure to establish appropriate, failure to achieve the required outputs associated with prioritising and maintaining the resources and responsibilities associated with the city-region, deep-region deal, that covers everything. And I would expect you to have a view about that. I think what's really interesting for members is the risks attached to specific schemes. And I think, personally, I'd like to go a little bit beyond just getting an assurance that all is well in the world, or will be. I'd like to know about specific schemes, about what a chance could go wrong.
If other members are chair wish to, then it's very simple for us either to send round the output of the programme management report that already goes to the combined authority, or have the programme unit, management unit, provide you with something for the next meeting that deals with that.
Can I just make a council maybe?
Well, I'm not sure that this committee needs to see all that detail. We are dealing with the corporate risk register, and if that detail is available to members on the website, or if the officers wish to provide a link for members to have a look at, I think that would be sufficient. I don't think it needs to come to the committee.
Just respond to that. I mean, the Sefton Audit Governance Committee does precisely that, looks at specific big schemes and specific service delivery areas. So there is precedence here. Obviously, if it's not the natural history of this organisation, then we can do things differently. But I personally find it helpful.
Okay, so thank you.
Can we now agree to the recommendation set out on page 67, please? We're now on to section 9. The purpose of this report is to provide the committee with the draft results of the Mercer audit and combined authority accounts to consider. Can I invite Sarah Johnson, Head of Finance, to take us through the report? Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you, Chair. This report
report sets out the results of Mazar's audit thus far and provides, for your information, a draft audit completion report together with a set of draft accounts. Now, the audits and accounts regulations require that the Chief Financial Officer certifies a set of draft accounts by the 31st of March May each year, that deadline was due in May. We then start to get into the audit process, and Mazar's, the external auditors, begin on site and work between June and July each year. As at this point in time, the audit is still ongoing, so for your information, a set of draft accounts and a draft audit completion report are attached to this, this report. I don't propose to say more about this at this juncture. So I hand over to Gareth, who will give an update on the audit completion report.
So we, I'm Gareth from the auditors. This is our first year through with you, so it's the first year of Mazar's audit in both the Combined Authority and Mersey Travel under the Cllr contract. We issued our report to you just under 2 weeks ago, and at that point it was a progress report, which ordinarily you would expect to come to this meeting and update on issues and must be in a position to sign. So what I'm proposing to members is talk through the report. There is a matter that has arisen, which means that we're probably not going to be able to sign off in time for the 31st of July deadline, but hopefully I will give members the information related to that on the way through the report. Is that okay, Chair?
Thank you,
Gareth. So in terms of the draft audit completion report, as I said, I will take it as read. This document effectively summarises the committee's conclusions of our work. What we would have expected to do was to have issued an update of this with further conclusions. So if I take the committee to page 4, which is probably the most crucial area. We highlighted in this report 2 weeks ago a number of areas which had a status around their completion and how we thought they may be completed. In the vast majority of those cases, those pieces of work have been completed successfully. In particular, one of the red areas was the pension liability. Now, the pension liability was an issue across the whole sector. As regards, there was a legal case after the 31st of May accounts were approved that actually meant that management needed to reassess their pension liability. It was called the McLeod case. That was all done, and actually the result of that is an immaterial adjustment. There'll be no adjustment to the accounts. The remainder of our work has all progressed satisfactorily.